Welcome back to Durban and the second Cambridge Nedbank Coppuccino, our daily dash through the cryptic corridors of COP17. Today's guest is the president of Greenpeace, international lobby group and civil society organization, Kumi Naidu. Kumi, welcome to the Coppuccino.
Thank you, Richard.
And welcome home, because this is your home city. Now, some 20 or more years ago, you were first arrested in the city when you were protesting against apartheid. Do you see climate change and its threat as something comparable? Would civil disobedience ever be justified?
Well, actually, if you look at the apartheid injustice, it affected people in our country, one country, right? When we look at climate change and its impact, it's affecting all of us across the world. And if the challenge of ending apartheid was an important one where we were willing to put our lives on the line, when our children and grandchildren's future is at stake throughout the world, I think it's now become incumbent on us to bring moral pressure on those that have power to act with not only the urgency, but with the pace that the situation calls for. We should also just look at what history teaches us on the question of how change actually happens. Whether we're talking about colonialism, slavery, civil rights in the United States, a woman's right to vote, apartheid, and so on, all of these struggles only really move forward when decent men and women stood up and said, enough is enough and no more.
And on the subject of people's pressure and protest, the other thing that's changed over the last 2 years since Copenhagen, apart from the economic crisis, is the Arab Spring, the Occupy movement, and so on. Do you see a relationship between those geopolitical changes and the case for urgent climate change action?
Yes, there is a connection, and one of the connections that's obvious, I think, is the Occupy movement in particular is driven by a sense of feeling that corporate power has become disproportionately too powerful and is undermining democracy. Because one of the ideas behind democracy is that the wallet of people with capital was supposed to be balanced by the ballot, right? And clearly, if we look at many of the important countries around the world today, the people who are really influencing national policy to a large extent are people who are running polluting corporations.
It's day three. You haven't yet been arrested or felt the need to tie yourself to any sort of bit of equipment or building?
Well, just to say there's 9 days to go.
And this afternoon, the Green Climate Fund's Transitional Committee reports back to the full COP, doesn't it? And so
yes,
we'll get a sense of the politics there, because the Transitional Committee couldn't reach full agreement on the institutional arrangements. What would you like to see? How would you think the Green Climate Fund should operate?
The big questions are, how do we ensure that the money is at sufficient level that we can actually support a majority of vulnerable countries that are needing the support right now?
Yes.
And so that they can have the resources not to follow the same dirty energy path,
yes,
that developed countries followed to strengthen and build their economies.
The economic conditions have changed. There's a new realism, and developed countries want to see results, not restitution. Are you willing to accept that new paradigm, or is the argument around justice still as strong as ever?
The argument for justice is always strong. It cannot be undermined, and it doesn't mean that, in fact, you can't actually have a marrying of the need for justice, but with a sense of realism and pragmatism. But however, developed countries must realize that people in developing world, when we look at their practice and we look at when they have political will, the kinds of resources they can mobilize overnight does not allow them to use the fact that they're having a financial crisis now, which is of their own making. Developing countries didn't create it. So, you know, if they can mobilize for war in Afghanistan, Libya, wherever, whatever the justification and pros and cons, they seem to be able to mobilize in the billions of dollars. And the best example is if overnight they could have mobilized not millions, not billions, but trillions of dollars to bail out the banks, the bankers, and the bonuses, why can't a fraction of that money be actually mobilized to fund the Green Climate Fund in a positive
way? And presumably you support, therefore, the Tobin tax on international financial transactions.
Yes. And essentially, we need to look at innovative forms of new finance. And there are three forms that we are pushing for here. One is for aviation tax, two is for a shipping tax, based on the sort of principle that the polluter should pay principle. But the financial transaction tax, which would actually be quite a painless tax, and has two benefits, by the way, not just to mobilize funding for climate and other development needs, but also it actually will prevent the kind of cavalier adventurism that we've seen on the part of hedge fund managers and so on, where they bet against currencies and shift large amounts of money. It'll bring some sort of discipline into the way capital flows across borders. And you know, we're talking about a very fraction of a percent of money that flows being taxed. And but that, in our calculation, and that of governments like the Sarkozy's in France, arguing would generate in the region of in excess of 50 to 80 billion a year. You know, the one conundrum that the business community and the role of business we have is this, though. It's in the DNA of business to want to do more, more, more. More profits, more products, more geographical spaces where they're operating. And I think the difficult elephant in the room is that the world cannot cope with more, 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 especially when a lot of the products that the business community as a whole is delivering are actually vanity products, they are not basic needs, and so on and so forth. But our difficulty is if business cannot move as fast as our children's and grandchildren's interests tell us we need to move, then we have no ethical option but to keep also strong pressure on companies.
Kumi Naidoo, thanks very much for joining us on the Daily Cappuccino.
Thank you, Richard.